Georgia.
We on the grind,
Georgia.
All the time, it ain't nothing on my mind, but
Georgia.
We ain't playing with you.
All right, I guess it's up to me next. My name is Amias Gerety. I'm a partner with QED Investors. We're a fintech-focused venture capital firm headquartered in Alexandria, Virginia. And Raj appears to have dropped, but I'll introduce him so he doesn't have to sit uncomfortably while I extol his virtues. Raj Date and I have known each other for going on 12 years. Ordinarily, Raj is introduced as the managing partner and head of Fenway Summer, which is an investment advisory and fintech advisory and investment firm. He's got huge credibility in the fintech space. He's invested across both the fintech and the crypto and DeFi ecosystem. So we'll talk about that. Before that, he was the deputy director at the CFPB. And he was earlier in his career the lead investment banker for Deutsche Bank, covering financial institutions, and SVP for strategy at Capital One. But Raj and I got to know each other when he had quit Deutsche Bank and was thinking about government service, and decided to create a one-man think tank, which he called Cambridge Winter. And he just started writing about what he thought the financial regulation looked like in the future. That I was at the time working at the Treasury Department, and so we called Raj. We tried to convince him to come join Treasury, and pretty shortly he had a better offer to go work with Elizabeth Warren in founding the CFPB, and so Raj did not have the opportunity to be my boss in that instance. But we got to know each other then, and I think that the name Fenway Summer certainly echoes those Cambridge winter days. But he's now in the South, and I'm sure a staunch Nationals fan, right, Raj?
Well, you know, it's a different league, and so I can support both.
Okay, good, excellent. Well, so Raj, the name of this panel is FinTech Comes of Age, and so let's start there. I would count this as at least the second time FinTech has come of age, with the first time. I would rate that as sort of the now appears to have been a false dawn of the IPO of Lending Club and the IPO of OnDeck. What do you make of the FinTech Comes of Age? Is this the second time, the third time, the first time? How do you put us in historical context here?
Well, you know, as you probably just recounted, I have spent / wasted more or less my entire career around financial services. So I feel like they're probably lots of times in my career alone where you could say that there was a real or a false dawn. But let's use the one that you mentioned. So Lending Club astonishingly went public, what was it? It would have been fourth quarter of 2014. And you know, I'd spent time around a lot of specialty finance investment bankers over the years, and you know, all these guys were sort of grumpy and saying, well, you know, this is all just a bunch of nonsense. It's basically just another monoline finance company. And, you know, sure, Lending Club is worth $10 billion. Well, then Capital One should be worth $1 trillion, and it's not. So therefore, something's got to give. And those kind of folks were
Capital One stock that you would have owned really would have been great at a $1 trillion valuation.
That's right. That's right. It'd be right around the strike price. But I think that, you know, the Lending Club kind of post IPO performance in the equity markets was greeted with a certain amount of, you know, smugness by those cynics. But I think that, you know, the challenges faced by firms like OnDeck and Lending Club are mostly the challenges associated with monoline cyclical credit businesses that are funded mostly in the wholesale markets. And so that doesn't mean that the technological breakthroughs that started to show themselves at that time and prior were real. So efficient distribution, decisioning with wider data sets and superior analytics, better and more efficient internal workflow aided by technology with less rework, all of those things were real. But I think the real test, the first real test of fintech firms really has been this last year and a half, the test of the pandemic, when suddenly, you know, it's not just for convenience anymore. We need to use financial services firms in order to distribute relief and enable remote fulfillment. allow customers to adapt their behavior to the times. A lot of those changes might well be more plastic than elastic. That is to say, they might stick as we move forward here. And so I think that it is a bit of a dawn for fintech firms. And now it's you know, considering how it is that you and I these days spend our day jobs, it's tempting to think of that dawn as relating just to venture-backed startups and the like. But you know, the reality is that there are lots of firms that are using technology and thinking about technology differently now than they would have a decade or two ago. And that is enabling kind of the fintech, even in large institutions. I think you know that I spend time as sort of the founding director of something called the Payments Leadership Council, which is the CEOs of the seven biggest US payments firms. And the reality is that those firms, which are, you know, sort of household names, right? Visa, MasterCard, American Express, Discover, FIS, et cetera, they helped enable e-commerce, like retail e-commerce increase year over year of like 40%, like a mind-boggling change in behavior. And absent sort of a continual investment in technology over the years, we would not have come through this as well as an industry. And so, I'm optimistic.
This point about valuation is really key, Raj, because LendingClub, you know, still exists today, just bought a bank. That's an interesting endpoint for their, existence. And it certainly jibes with something that we often say inside of QED, which is every fintech either becomes a bank, gets bought by a bank, or finds some sustainable partnership with banks. Because at some level, if you're in payments and you're in lending, banks are in the picture. But you made some interesting points, I think, especially about valuation, which is there's a narrative element to how you get received in the stock market. And then there's the prove it element. And what LendingClub really failed to do was to match the reality of their performance over many years with the reality of the narrative that they sold when they IPO'd. And I think we see, I saw a Twitter thread the other day that said, you know, venture capitalist A says, I definitely don't want to invest in lending business. I want to invest in payments businesses. Oh, Affirm, that looks great. Upstart, terrific. You know, like, can I get net, you know, can I finance, inventory receivables? That's a great payments business, right? And we can laugh and say, well, those are just lending businesses, or they might perform about payments like payments businesses do. In other words, they might perform over time with stronger secular rather than cyclical growth. They might perform with stronger margin characteristics. They might perform as software business or as tech-enabled businesses. And I do think that we still haven't quite gotten past the stage where we just whisper the magic words and hope that the market gives us a valuation, and into the stage where every company knows they really have to prove it quarter over quarter in order to succeed in public markets.
Yeah, you know, in fact, maybe let's just kind of play with this a little bit, which is, you know, it might be a useful path towards what is a fintech anyway. So,
right.
Because at some level, it's confusing because it's a convenient term for all kinds of firms to use. So for example, you know, banks, when they complain about, you know, getting regulated too much, they talk about, look at those awful fintechs who aren't regulated at all. And then, you know, fintech firms and their venture capital backers, you know, will try to disassociate oneself from the valuation multiples typically associated with insurance companies or banks or something. Right. And all that's natural, but let's take your theme, sort of what actually drives a delta in value, and think about what goes into it. So it's probably a handful of things. Like, are these businesses that have scalability through technology or not? Are they businesses that have flexibility and adaptability through the use of technology or not? Is it the kind of business you see increasing returns to scale in the way that you would see with like a software business typically? Or like a software business, is this kind of business where you have really disproportionate returns based on disparate talent?
Right.
And where those things are true, I think of that as sort of a fintech application. The nice thing is it's sufficiently malleable to allow us to invest in lots of different things. That's kind of how I think about it. It sounds like we have sort of converged on a similar set of perspectives.
Yeah, because ultimately, the purpose of tech in fintech is to signal yourself, if you're an entrepreneur or an investor, as a fast-growing, high-margin business. Ultimately, it's a valuation claim, more than any other claim than I think it is. And I do think that fintech, to your point, really is financial services. There are financial services software companies. Those can be called fintech. Now, is FIS a fintech? It's definitely a software company. It's typically thought of as a financial services company. It happens to get the valuations of a software company because it sells software. Do you think that there is a meaningful distinction that will be drawn out, call it 10 years hence, Raj, or 10 years hence, is it just going to be redefined financial services and there will be high performing, fast growing financial services companies and lower performing and slower growing financial services companies? And there will be software companies that serve financial services and software companies that don't serve financial services. How do you think the line gets drawn a decade hence?
Yeah, I think all of those lines get drawn from a functional and kind of strategy setting point of view. So is this the kind of customer that directly serves customers, or is it, you know, consumers and small businesses, commercial enterprises, or is it a wholesale plumbing infrastructure type business? Is it something that is capital intensive, because typically because either high volatility or because of balance sheet intensity or not? So those sort of strategic lines, I think, will continue to refine themselves and resolve themselves and guide how it is that people think about what markets to play in and how to play in them. My guess, though, is that even 10 years from now, the most talked about distinctions will be the ones that demarcate what sometimes can feel like relatively arbitrary differences in regulatory treatment, supervisory intensity, the number and variety of regulatory stakeholders that a firm might have. People talk about and complain about those issues a lot, which doesn't mean that they're not real. And I don't think that we're particularly close from a policy point of view to ironing out a lot of those problems. I think that they will be with us in one form or another for some time.
Yeah, I once was in a room full of fintech executives and they started to complain like bankers. And I told them, look, I thought that, you know, fintech and financial services and banking were going to converge, but I didn't know that you'd converge on complaining about the regulations before you converged in terms of valuation and importance to the economy. But there is something to this Jamie Dimon critique, right, where he says, you know, you guys are you know, unregulated and I'm regulated and you know, sort of the complaining about it. Now, there's one sense in which it's just true. There's another sense, Raj, in which I'm not sure what the point is, right? If Jamie Dimon wanted to spin off his payments business and not have it be attached to his bank, he could do that.
Yeah.
Now, he would lose some of the advantages of that payment business, which is that he is a bank connector to the fintech ecosystem. So he could not actually have the same business that he has today if he spun it off. So there's some real value in the charter and the regulatory burden that he or other banks take on. And it seems odd to complain about the burdens of having those advantages.
You know, this topic reminds me of during the Dodd-Frank deliberations, Barney Frank would point out how it is that every person in financial services would complain to him about an unlevel playing field, and he just couldn't figure out how it could be true for everyone that they're on the short end of the stick. And part of that is, I suppose, understandable human nature. But I think that what it sometimes obscures is what I think the real opportunity is. First of all, like I gotta say, like, you know, I don't envy Jamie Dimon, right? He seems like he has a hard job. He's 100 times better at it than I would ever be. But one of the reasons that I don't not envy him is it's not because of somehow JP Morgan doesn't have structural advantages or enough structural advantages. I mean, that sounds like manifestly not true. That said, I think for institutions that are less sort of deftly managed, it is possible for the superstructure of regulatory oversight to introduce kind of a cultural sclerosis that does not suit a fast-moving market. And, you know, to me, that is the single biggest advantage that some of the firms that we work with have. And it's not,
that's right.
And it's not just a matter of like the rules somehow being different. In general, the rules are kind of the same for similar looking functions. That's not perfect, that's
right,
for sure, but it's better now than it was pre-Dodd-Frank. But they're in a business that tends to encourage scale, you will inherit the curses of bigness And that bigness coupled with oversight and risk asymmetry, you know, like regulators rarely will pat you on the back for doing a great job, but they notice if you don't. That tends to create longer cycle times and more inertia than is, I think, competitively viable long term.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that we often say to banks when we're talking to them is, you can have a great strategy as a bank, but just being a bank doesn't mean you have a great strategy. Just being a bank won't make you succeed. And it's true that the last 30 to 40 years of U.S. financial history has been to remove the competitive moats that banks had, right? We allowed interstate branching. That made it a lot harder to be a community bank. Mm-hmm. Closer to 50 years ago, we created the money market fund industry. That made it a lot harder to be a bank. So it's certainly true that competition has made it more difficult.
And even now, we're debating whether or not we remove some of the remaining kind of structural advantages of bankness. I mean, if the sine qua non of bankiness is I have privileged access to liabilities, I have privileged access to the payments rails, I have privileged access to state law preemption, and privileged access to customer data. Each one of those things is in play, with the possible exception, but even there, of privileged access to insured liabilities. But you know, customer data is way more accessible by people other than the bank today, and that may be even further liberalized, depending on what the CFPB does with some important and rulemaking going forward. I think that the access to state law preemption, you know, through partnership models and otherwise, you know, has been under some pressure for some time. And the access to payments rails, like there's a lot of innovative payments companies that have found ways to be able to make do even without the same kind of equal access to, you know, Fenwire that a bank would enjoy.
Yeah, and as you know, full disclosure, both QED and I think you, Raj, are an investor in one of those such companies.
Yeah. So. Yes. The nice thing about having a relatively large portfolio is that you eventually assume that you somehow have an interest in everything. So
exactly. So let's close with 1 minute on DeFi. You know, Raj, I remember a meeting in maybe 2015 in which you were describing Circle to me. So you've been around the block here. Do you think that this is also a dawn for a more functional version of crypto and DeFi, or are we just getting another round of arcade game style volatility and speculation?
Both. So I am optimistic on the verge of seeing some good uses of streamlined approaches to new rails that are programmable and open and probably require less rent seeking by intermediaries. I think that probably is true. I also think it is probably true that we'll continue to see a lot of just silliness for sure. And so I think that the challenge for all of us is being able to tell which is which.
Yeah, for sure. Well, Raj, always a pleasure. Thank you so much to the FinTech South folks. And I think we are on to Chris Brummer and Gene Ludwig. So this is you'll be trading up both on the moderator and on the interview.
Yeah.
No offense, Raj.
It's nice to be the opening act with you, Amias. Great to see you.
All right. Thanks, everybody.
Georgia. We on the grind in Georgia. All the time. It ain't nothing on my mind, but Georgia.